I'm Vic Coulard from London, and I think the whole issue is that ultrasound has been available for well over 30 years. Technically, it's been improving. There have been many improvements in terms of resolution and also going from 2D to 3D. And one of the key questions which we all have is, how can we use this in our practice? And we have two excellent speakers, Matthias Olke, he's Professor of Urology from Hanover Medical School, and Professor Hans-Dieter Peter Dietz from the Sydney Medical School in Nepean, will both be talking about different aspects of ultrasound. I hope you will get a feeling of its clinical applicability. And at the end, I hope that we will be able to ask questions as to how this could be used in our clinic, what training is required, what equipment is required, so perhaps you can get some clinical utility from this. I'd like to ask our first speaker, Matthias Olke, to talk about applications in incontinence and overactive bladder. Matthias.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for the invitation. Thank you very much for joining us. We have the topics urinary incontinence, urgency incontinence, stress urinary incontinence, and prolapse. And I would like to cover OAB and urinary incontinence and would like to show you what we can do with ultrasound. In principle, we are talking about biomarkers. So what is a biomarker? A biomarker can constitute any objectively measurable indicator of a biological process and can have three purposes. Number one, it can be used to diagnose a disease or condition. Number two, it's a tool to assess the severity or progression of a disease or a condition. And number three, it's an indicator of a disease or condition, a prognosis, including prediction of response to specific treatments or therapies. So what are the biomarkers we can use for OAB or urgency urinary incontinence? And number one biomarker, which we all use, is a filling cystometry. And what we can see is detrusor overactivity. As you can see here is the detrusor pressure, and you can see the involuntary detrusor contractions. This is a biomarker of OAB or urgency incontinence, especially when it's associated here with urinary incontinence in the flow channel. Another biomarker, these are urine biomarkers, for example, C-reactive protein, prostaglandin E2, or nerve growth factor is another one. We have genetic biomarkers that are associated with urgency incontinence. It's RS4994, single nucleotide polymorphism of the beta-3 receptor, or function SNPs of cytochrome P450 in the liver called CYP2D6. And these are genetic biomarkers. Or we have imaging biomarkers like the spinning top, bladder neck, bladder trabeculation, vesicle ureter reflux, or bladder wall thickness, enlargement of bladder wall thickness. So these are the biomarkers we can use to prove a disease, or we can detect a disease progression, or we can predict treatment outcome. Let me go a little bit more into the details. Here we have the three imaging techniques that has been described in the literature. We have three techniques. The transvaginal one, it's the oldest one. I will talk a little bit about this one. I will just mention the transperineal technique and the suprapubic technique. It's all dependent on the location of the ultrasound array where you image the bladder. Obviously, the transvaginal technique, this one, is the most popular because it's the oldest technique, and I would like to focus in my talk about this technique. So this is the first technique described already in 1994 by Vikula. He's our chairman here today, so I would like to name this the Kula technique. So it's almost 20 years old. It's about transvaginal measurement of bladder wall thickness after voiding, and you should have a bladder filling volume of 50 ml or less. So there is a rationale why it should be 50 ml or less. And the ratio you can see here, you can see bladder wall thickness against bladder filling, and you can see no significant differences in the first 50 milliliters of bladder filling, but when you fill the bladder more than 50 milliliters, the bladder wall thickness goes down. So you are in the same state of bladder filling when the bladder is filled less than 50 ml. You measure bladder wall thickness at the anterior wall, at the dome, and at trigone, and calculate a mean value. There is an intra-reader variability, and we can judge the intra-reader variability in quality assessment. So, for example, when we judge the quality of the images in the shrink study, you've heard in the morning session about the shrink study, we came to the conclusion that more than 85% of the images were judged in the same way by the same investigator at two different time periods. And when we look at the measurement results, we have an intra-observer variability of less than 10%. The same applies for the inter-reader variability, so when you compare two different observers, and there is the judgment of image quality, it's more than 90% identical. Is it good or is it not good? Is it fair? Can you read the measurements or not? It's identical in 90%. And the difference between reader 1 and reader 2 is less than 10%. You will end up in images looking like this, and I will show you a bigger enlargement of this image a little bit later. So what you do is you use a transvaginal ultrasound probe with a high frequency. So you should use a frequency of 7.5 megahertz or more. The probe location with the transvaginal technique is close to the bladder, and you don't have any tissue interference, and you're ending up with high-quality image like this. You can see here the transvaginal probe. You can see the urethra, the bladder lumen, and here the bladder walls. And you measure the trigone, the dome anterior wall, divided by 3, and this is mean bladder wall thickness according to the Kuller technique. We always have to consider that the ultrasound frequency we use is important. So there's a theoretical basis around. The depth of penetration of the ultrasound waves is frequency dependent. If you use a 2.5 or 3.5 megahertz ultrasound probe, you only have a very deep penetration of the ultrasound waves, but it gives less image quality. If you use high-frequency ultrasound waves, for example, 7.5 megahertz or more, it only penetrates superficially, but it gives a higher image resolution. So it means that you have to use a high-frequency ultrasound probe and have to bring it very close to the organ, and this is guaranteed if you use a transvaginal technique. You can even measure the measurement mistake you make by the ultrasound frequency. And this is a theoretical value. So when you have two separate dots, what is the difference of the two dots that you can still see the two dots? And if you have a 7.5 megahertz system, then the measurement mistake is less than 0.13 millimeters. So if a dot is in a distance of more than 1.3 millimeters, you can identify those two points as two separate dots. However, if you use a 3.5 megahertz probe, the measurement mistake is 0.3 millimeters. So if you have two dots in the distance of 0.5 millimeters, you cannot identify those as two separate dots. Let's come back to the original question or the original purposes. So three purposes, and we will run through with ultrasound measurement of bladder wall thickness. Number one, used to diagnose a disease or condition. Number two, it's a tool to assess the severity or progression of a disease, and it's an indicator of condition prognosis, including prediction of treatment outcome. Let's look into the diagnosis of a disease. Bladder wall thickness is significantly thicker in female patients with OAB or urgency incontinence compared to patients with stress urinary incontinence or mixed incontinence. And I would like to present you data from the first publication by Vikula, and you can see the normals. You can see stress urinary incontinence, detrusor overactivity, mixed incontinence, and voiding dysfunction. And you can see that this line or this bladder wall thickness is significantly thicker compared to normals, compared to stress urinary incontinence, and even compared to mixed incontinence. This is one study. Another study showing here stress incontinence, diffuser overactivity, incontinence, and bladder outlet obstruction women. But if you compare the two diseases with incontinence, there is a significantly thicker bladder wall compared to stress urinary incontinent people. There are suggested threshold values. So if you measure less than 50 milliliters of bladder filling, the threshold value of 5 millimeters seems to be the right value to diagnose or exclude diffuser overactivity. You have a sensitivity of bladder wall thickness with a threshold value of 5 millimeters of 84% and a specificity of 89%. You may want to use the positive predictive value. And the positive predictive value is 6.5 milliliters, a fixed 6.5 millimeters, to have 100% diagnosis of diffuser overactivity. So if you put in the probe, fill the bladder less than 50 ml, and have a value of 6.5 millimeters or more, you have a chance of 100% that you can diagnose diffuser overactivity. Let's look into the tool to assess the severity or progression of a disease. What can we do? Here we have the data of the SHRINK study. And this is part of the poster we presented at the EAU Congress, and Dudley Robinson was the first author. And I would like to draw your attention to OABQ symptom severity. And you can see there is a significant correlation between symptom severity and bladder wall thickness measured in the same technique, and also to PPPC, patient perception of bladder condition. This is a significant association with bladder wall thickness. So it doesn't even say it is increased in patients with diffuser overactivity incontinence. It's also dependent on the disease severity. However, until now, we don't have a longitudinal study on ultrasound bladder wall thickness measurements available to study the natural course of the disease. But we can use this technique to screen a population to find out what is the natural course of a disease, because the biomarker tells something about disease severity. And it is suitable as a minimal invasive tool to prospectively evaluate disease progression in longitudinal epidemiological studies. And what we would expect, and this is purely hypothetical, is we have an increase in bladder wall thickness in patients with increasing symptoms and symptom burden, and we would expect we have a decrease in bladder wall thickness in patients with a decreasing symptom severity or symptom burden. So let's look in the indicator of a disease prognosis or including a prediction of response to specific therapies. And we can use bladder wall thickness to show that we can treat diffuser overactivity, or we can treat overactive bladder, and we can show significant differences before and after the treatment when the patient reports a good treatment outcome. So I've brought you three different studies. Studies number one is the first study that had been done. It's a monocenter study at King's College. It was already done in the 90s. And 50 patients were treated, 50 patients, female patients with diffuser overactivity were treated with oxybutynin two times daily, 2.5 milligrams, or with placebo. And we did a transvaginal measurement at the beginning and after 6 weeks. And what you can see with the oxybutynin-treated patients, there was a significant drop in these bladder wall thickness measurements after 6 weeks. And it was a difference of 1.3 millimeters on average. When we compare those to the placebo, it stayed stable. So there was a first indicator that we can treat OAB, and the patient tells us subjectively it's working, but we have now an objective measure that it also decreases bladder wall thickness. The second study I would like to present, it's a multicenter study of 11 hospitals in the UK. There were 79 patients with OAB. Of those were treated 37 patients with torterodine, 42 with placebo, with a mean age of 47 years. Was a 12-week placebo-controlled study followed by a 12-week open-label study. The mean bladder wall thickness at the beginning was 6.7 millimeters with torterodine and 6.2 for placebo. And you can see the results here. This is the double-blind study baseline. You have a slight decrease with placebo, but you have a strong decrease by almost 1 millimeter with with tolterodine. And when you go open to the open label study, and that means that patients with placebo were now treated with tolterodine, you have a significant increase also in these patients. But the effect size was not 1.3 millimeters. Now it's close to 1 millimeter. The latest study and the biggest study is the SHRINK study. And this is the result of a SHRINK study. There were 79 centers in 20 countries included. We selected 501 women with proven diffuser overactivity in urodynamics. Of those were treated with solifenacine 5 milligram, 175 patients, with 10 milligrams, 155 patients, and 175 for placebo, mean age 55 years. This was a randomized 12-week placebo-controlled study with blinded reviewers. So the reviewer did not know, is it a placebo-treated patient, is it a solifenacine-treated patient, is it baseline, is it week 12? So I was one of the reviewers. I was completely blinded, and I didn't know anything about the patient. Mean bladder wall thickness was a little bit less than in the other studies. It was close to 5 millimeters in all the three treatment groups. And what you can see, at least for solifenacine 5 milligram, there was a significant decrease in bladder wall thickness after 12 weeks of treatment. And by coincidence, the 5 milligram treatment group was more symptomatic than the 10 milligram treatment group. So this reflected in a decrease in bladder wall thickness also in this study. So this is already my last slide to make the conclusion. The ultrasound measurement of bladder wall thickness is a biomarker of OAB or urgency incontinence. The majority of data is available with the transvaginal technique. There are some publications with the suprapubic technique. There are some publications with the transperineal or translabial technique. Bladder wall thickness can diagnose female OAB or urgency incontinence, and the threshold value with a bladder filling of less than 50 milliliters is 5 millimeters. Bladder wall thickness also correlates with symptom bother. Bladder wall thickness measurement could be a useful parameter to prospectively investigate these patients. Bladder wall thickness decreases significantly with adequate treatment. However, we need more studies to objectively quantify this issue. And if you are interested to read a little bit about more, there is going to be one article Vikula and Hesse-Weixer I wrote. It's already published online, where we have put all together the measurement data of bladder wall thickness. It's going to be available as a paper version from November on, but it's already published online. Thank you very much.